Morning, Tasha.
Good morning.
Good morning, Mr. Gill. I see you on there. I think I've said hello to everybody.
Thank you.
Good morning, it's Gigi.
Hi, Gigi.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning, everybody.
There you go. Good morning.
Good morning. Now, how do I mute my phone?
Star six.
Okay, thank you. This is Cecilia.
Hi, Cecilia.
Let's see if it's working.
Good morning, Cecilia.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Good
morning.
Good
morning,
Dale.
Hi,
guys. Hi, Donald.
Hey, Dale.
Hi, Don. How are you?
Good, good. How are you?
Good, good.
Good. GG, good.
All right, everybody, I'm good to go. I'm going to go ahead and mute everyone. I do see some changes have been made since I was last on the Zoom client, so it doesn't look like I have the ability to unmute you at the end of the service like I had been doing. Instead, it just says ask all to unmute. So when we get to that point at the end of the service during the Cacophony of Saints, I'll just go ahead and click that and see what happens. I've actually never used that functionality. So at this time, I'm going to go ahead and mute all. 1 moment. Okie doke. All right. And just to be absolutely sure, give me a thumbs up if you can still hear my voice. Thank you very much. All right. So thank you very much for the welcome back. I am so glad to be back with y'all. So the first thing I wanted to address before I begin anything is I had heard that there were several technical difficulties that occurred during the weeks that I was gone. I was gone for about 6 weeks. And thank you, by the way, for those 6 weeks. It was just so good to be able to like be with my newborn and to really participate as fully as possible. Well, as fully as a father can participate in the life of their young child. But anyhow, so when someone else, someone other than myself or someone with the setup that I have, because that's an important point, tries to operate Zoom for several clients, several people. Unfortunately, when it comes to things like screen sharing or anything like that, you're really at the mercy of that person's internet connection, hardware. There's all kinds of technical things that could happen. And in reviewing, because let me tell you, folks, like first off, anyone who hosted, so Tasha, I believe Beth Sweet did once, anyone who hosted at all, thank you for going through that process and giving it a shot, because that was incredible. I heard you guys did some amazing things, by the way, like testimonies, which like, amen, like praise be to God, that is wonderful. And you made it happen. But again, technology is what it is. It took me several weeks to be able to just get to the point where I'm at when it comes to hosting the services. There's no manual for this. I mean, there's a manual for Zoom, but there's no manual for online worship. Most of the churches that I know that were doing online worship before COVID, they had like tech people and, you know, paid staff people. And I'm just like, I don't got that kind of money. Come on. Like, and I also benefited from, you might remember Bruce McCubbin, my father-in-law. He and Pat just moved into a new condo in Towson, and he had to get rid of all his pro audio equipment. For 30 years, he had done DJing and other pro audio type stuff. And I became the beneficiary of a lot of that equipment, which allowed me to basically put on the service that you have been participating in. Otherwise, it's really tough to just run it from like a laptop without additional equipment. And I think a couple folks finally understood that. But, you know, it's my joy to continue to be able to offer worship in this format. It costs the church basically nothing to do it this way. And as long as folks enjoy it and feel like they're connecting to God through it, I'm more than happy to continue to offer it. And every single Sunday that goes by, I try to improve it a little bit more. I try to either get access to new tech or learn a new best practice. And I'm constantly studying the best way to do that. So anyhow, thank you for hanging in there. It's just, again, wonderful to see all of you. Rather than take any more time, I just wanted to ask if Tasha would be willing, sorry to put you on the spot like that, to offer just a brief announcement about Trunk or Treat. By the way, sorry about the announcement in the bulletin that I put in. I failed to mention the part about registering cars, so maybe you can talk about that.
Sure, no worries. Trunk or Treat is going to be on Halloween this year, which is October 31st. We're doing it from 2 to 4. Registration is online at Eventbrite. The link is on all three of our Facebook pages. It's on the Young Adult page, and excuse me, Ms. Beth sent the flyer out for me. If you need the link, you can always text or call me, email me, and I'll be happy to send it to you. If you're going to participate, if you have a child, neighbor, whomever that's going to participate, they must register. If they are not registered, they will not be allowed on the premises. I have to do COVID-19 tracing in order to make sure that we are all safe and I know who is there and who is not there. The tickets online are broken out by time frame. So there's a 15-minute entry point for each group, and each group has 20 people. At the bottom, I noticed some people had issues with registration. So at the bottom, so there's tickets for 2 through 4 in 15-minute increments. And then there's a decorated car ticket. If you are doing your car, I need you to do decorated car ticket. Do not pick a time slot, decorated car only. If you're decorating a car, do, and a kid was coming with you, do a decorated car slot ticket and pick a time slot for that child to trunk or treat. People can only trunk or treat during their time slot. I've got to be very, very cautious. I've already had 2 COVID scares at this point. I'm not trying to have any more. And if you all haven't been through it, when it comes down to having to do contact tracing and the information that the state wants, the information that different organizations want, it is not fun. So I need to make sure that all of my records are up to date and I know exactly who is there. So please register. Please do not call me. Please do not email me. Please do not text me and let me know that you're coming. I need the registration completed. Please. Thank you. Back to you, Em.
Thank you, Tasha. Oh, sorry about that. Okay, so anyway, let me tell you, I got to applaud Tasha for a second. Just lift her up for a second because all the steps that she is taking, that is the right thing to do. Let me tell you, those, we call them intakes at the health department. Those are no joke. Sometimes those can take upwards of 30 minutes, and depending on the number of contacts, it is ridiculous. It's a lot of questions. It takes up a lot of time. A lot of these are very probing questions, so if you might not be comfortable, you know, answering, to take the time beforehand when running an event to do your own contact tracing, that is incredibly helpful. So give her some kudos, please, because that's amazing. All right. So we're going to go ahead. Oh, I just wanted to quickly highlight. It's kind of a big deal, so I wanted to highlight it. I am sick and tired of waiting for our annual conference and our bishop to give clarifying advice as to the status of communion in churches. I know plenty of colleagues that had already been offering it to their congregations. I'm not comfortable with certain forms of ambiguity, specifically the kind that pertain to my pastoral calling, and communion would be one of them. So with that in mind, November 1st at 10 a.m., we're going to have our first communion service at Milford Mill. Read the announcement. It's lengthy. I won't cover it here, but there will be COVID protocols in place, but you will have an opportunity to come on site. It will be outdoors and receive Holy Communion with anyone that shows up. For those of you that will be joining by Zoom, you can join, of course, through the Zoom client as normal, if that's your preference, with camera, if you like, or you can just dial in if there's inclement weather. It's real simple. Everybody just get back into your cars, dial in, whatever you need to do with your smartphone or regular phone, and we'll go from there. I am asking that folks bring their own communion elements of bread and juice. If you can't, you just don't have the ability, no problem. We're going to have that covered as well if you need it, but ideally you'll want to bring your own elements. And that might just be a more enjoyable way to do communion anyway. I think a lot of people have a lot of preferences about what kind of bread we should use and what kind of juice we should use. Me, it's Hawaiian bread and Welch's grape juice. I don't know about you. Some people like pita bread. I don't understand those people. I'm not going to pretend to understand those people. But anyway, with that in mind, the other thing I wanted to talk about was just Charge Conference. It's going to be short this year. There's not really a lot that we'll be voting on. You can go ahead and update yourself in your announcements there. And then just one last thing I wanted to lift up was that the COVID-19 hotline for the Baltimore County Health Department is kind of like a one-stop shop for any of like your COVID-19 questions. They want you to call them. The schedule is posted there in the announcements. It's 410-887-3816. Just call during those times and they can answer questions, including if you are asked to quarantine, there is financial aid available through the state and I think federal as well, and some county stuff. So if you know somebody that is quarantining and they need financial aid, they have the ability to give gift cards, financial aid, things of that nature. People like myself can sign them up and we can go from there. All right, so let's go ahead and join together in our opening hymn. It's Take Up Thy Cross. Let me perform my screen share. I'm going to be freehanding this a little bit today because I have a program that I typically use to cue the videos, and unfortunately it wasn't working for me today, so I got to update that. All right, there's our screen share. All right, I'm going to play, and as soon as you hear the audio, just give me a thumbs up, okay? Thanks, guys. All right, let me go ahead and queue up our order of worship for today. All right, is that visible to you? Give me a thumbs up or down if you can read it well. Great, fantastic. All right, let's join together in our opening prayer. Come to us as a light from heaven, Sovereign. Pierce the shadows of our stubbornness and anger that we allow to rule our lives. Turn us from ways that deny your rule among us. Awaken us from the dull routines of our worship into ways alive with wonder, awe, and spontaneity. Remind us that we are gathered by Christ in faith, hope, and love. Amen. So at this time, we'll go ahead and collect our tithes and offerings. There's a link to the electronic giving portal in your worship bulletin today. You can also use PayPal alternatively, and you can search us out at mmumc@aol.com for that. There's a service fee that's usually deducted through the electronic means. Of course, you can continue to mail in your offerings or just reserve your offering until we meet together again in person. And we just thank you very much for continuing to help us to fund the ministry of this church, this growing ministry of Milford Mill United Methodist Church. So I'm going to go ahead and play our offertory. It's by Donnie McClurkin, and it's called I Need You. If there's a commercial at the beginning, I apologize. I'll do my best here.
When you need your bank, Capital One's top-rated app is right here. So you can check your balance, deposit checks, pay bills, or transfer money. When you don't need your bank, put it here. That's banking reimagined. What's in your wallet?
I'm going to go ahead and put that up.
Your hand holding me. How could I live without you? I could not see. Lord, what would I do in life? And where would I go? How would I handle things? All that I know.
I'm heart. Everybody, just say. Gotta mean it from your heart.
I need you.
Say you gotta mean it. Say you gotta mean it.
I need you.
Oh, yes I do.
I need you.
Just can't make it without it. Can't make it without
I need you.
Everybody sing. Everybody sing. Everybody sing.
I need you.
Just can't make it without you, can't make it without
I
need
you.
Not another day, not another moment, no.
I need you.
Yeah. Lord. All right, let me go ahead and play our doxology. Give me just 1 second, please. Let us pray. Gracious and holy God, we give you thanks for allowing us to come together as a church and as a family. We thank you for everything that you're doing to empower the good deeds that you would have us do. Lord, in these troubled times, we need your spirit to bless us, to help us to remember that we don't always have to have everything under control, that there is a force greater than us, more capable than us, that we can turn to, that we can rely upon. That force is you, Lord. You watch over everything. You know all things. And so, Lord, we turn over our wills to you today, our gratitude to you today, because we know that we can trust you, and we know that you can make a way where we don't see one. Help us to feel courage, to feel your plan in motion, and to participate in it fully, or at least as much as we can, as much as you give us the power, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, so you're in for a treat for this next one. So I had no idea that these three artists had come together to do this song. So Softly and Tenderly, Jesus is Calling is one of those classic church hymns. And Reba McEntire, Kelly Clarkson, and Trisha Yearwood came together to sing a rendition of it. This one has lyrics, so I'm gonna go ahead and put that up for you now.
USA,
I do apologize for these, there we go, I muted it. For these advertisements, it's just part of the YouTube experience, but we'll have that next week stripped of the videos. All right, there you are.
Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling. Calling for you and for me. See on the portals, he's waiting and watching, watching for you and for me. Come home, come home. Oh. calling, calling for you and for me. See on the portals, he's waiting and watching, watching for you and for me. Come home.
All right, let me bring up our scripture for today. So it's going to be Luke chapter 14, verses 15 to 24. Give me one moment. There we go. All right, and sometimes this is called the parable of the great banquet. So it says, when one of those at the table with him heard this, he said to Jesus, "Blessed is the one who will eat at the feast in the kingdom of God." And Jesus replied, "A certain man was preparing a great banquet and invited many guests. At the time of the banquet, he sent his servant to tell those who had been invited, 'Come, for everything is now ready.' But they all alike began to make excuses. The first said, 'I have just bought a field, and I must go and see it. Please excuse me.' Another said, 'I have just bought 5 yoke of oxen, and I'm on my way to try them out. Please excuse me.' And still another said, 'I just got married, so I can't come.' The servant came back and reported this to his master. And then the owner of the house became angry and ordered his servant, 'Go out quickly into the streets and alleys of the town and bring in the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame.' 'Sir,' the servant said, 'what you ordered has been done, but there is still room.' And then the master told his servant, 'Go out to the roads and country lanes and compel them to come in so that my house will be full. I tell you, not one of those who were invited will get a taste of my banquet.'" This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. And amen. So let me go ahead and close the screen share here. All right. So I must say, I don't actually know if you were able to see the sermon, the first sermon in the series, Driver's Ed, that I created. But, you know, I do have a little bit of a recap in here for you. So, what I will never forget are the words of it was like one of the first things the instructors of this driver's training course I took in Scottsdale, what they said to us before the lessons began, it's kind of burned into my memory. So they said, most drivers will never have cause to use the techniques we're about to show you. You know, we're not showing them to you expecting you to become experts overnight. And there was no reasonable way, by the way, that they could. This was a weekend. We're showing them to you because most drivers don't know what it feels like in their bodies to push a vehicle beyond its operational limits. And one of the worst things that can happen to you while driving is encountering a situation that you have zero experience with. We're going to do our best in the next several days to change that for you. And that really put me at ease because I was like, okay, good, because I know how to commute. I mean, but I'm not a good, you know, driver by any stretch of the imagination. And at that point, I had just started driving. But yeah, putting it in that reference, like, oh yeah, okay, you're right. Yeah, there are a lot of things that happen on the road that, you know, you just kind of pick them up as you drive, you know, years forward. So yeah, this will be great. What'll it be like to take a car out onto a slippery highway after some rain has fallen and just let it go out of control, you know, slip sideways and all that. So This is week two of the current sermon series. We paused last Sunday because of the special Sunday, and that was World Communion Sunday. I put that sermon, by the way, on the YouTube channel. So if you care to watch it, it's up there for you. Hopefully there should be no other issues with viewing it. Not sure what happened last time. The first sermon in our new series, Driver's Ed, dealt with the idea that life really has an influence on us in, you know, often many ways that we don't perceive. And likewise, it's really easy for us to neglect the care of our souls when the needs of our bodies always seem to take preference. We don't really understand spiritual concepts the way that we understand, you know, our bodies. You know, we dismiss a thousand daily cares because we're trying to go from one place to another. We have these goals in mind. And we never notice that each little care, as we address it, as we think about it, as we stress over it, it taxes us. And it can have a negative effect on our spirit if we fail to pay attention, you know, to what's going on inside. Much like, you know, the experience you might have driving somewhere and not remembering how you got there because, again, you weren't paying attention. You were so focused on the destination. So here in our second week, I wanted to share with you a little bit more about my experience in my younger days taking this advanced driver's training course. So we had a chance to drive these BMWs around, put them sort of through their paces, learning these techniques from pro drivers. And one of my favorite experiences was learning how to drift. Does anyone here know what drifting is? Yeah, so I gotta tell you, I feel like I was born to do it. I loved the experience. I kind of took to it naturally. There's something about it. So if you don't know what drifting is, it's sometimes you see, usually it's an accident, but you know, a car will kind of lose control and it'll kind of start to slip a little bit and slip and turn. You know, to do it in a controlled fashion to kind of help you to turn around an obstacle or something like that, that's drifting a vehicle. And I really liked it because there's something about drifting that really requires all your focus. You have to feel everything that is happening in the car, and it can be very disconcerting because the first instinct you have is, oh my God, the car is out of control. I need to get it back in control, which is precisely the wrong thing to do. Drifting in many ways is a lot like controlled chaos. You know, chaos happens every day. It happens around you all the time. But there's a way to kind of operate within the chaos, if you catch my meaning. And it's easy to mess up because sometimes we have, in the middle of a drift, the inclination to either overdo or underdo the things required to make it happen. Too much accelerator, not enough accelerator, jerking the wheel too far, not enough. And we're so focused on the outcome of the drift, which is to basically get around a cone on this S-curve track, and we want to feel like we're in control of the process, but it takes pro drivers years, sometimes decades, to be able to control a vehicle that way. And here we were trying to do it in a weekend, but I loved it. I wouldn't say I was terrific at it. I mean, I literally had 3 days experience, but you know, the knowledge has saved me, saved my life and my body multiple times since I took that course. Now, speaking of goals, Western society teaches us that goals are important. You know, we're very goal oriented. We have goals at work. We have goals at play, of all things. I think that's ridiculous. I mean, how many vacations have you taken where, you know, there just had to be a schedule, right? Some people thrive on the vacation schedule. I'm not one of those people. If I'm on vacation, I want to feel like I'm on vacation, not at work, not managing another schedule. Now, some might say that the vacation schedule helps them feel like, you know, they accomplished everything they wanted to accomplish on their vacation. You know, there was a lot of activities and interesting things to see and do and eat. You know, do the thing. Again, I'm not one of those people. We doggedly pursue our goals and we do what we can to minimize the time and sometimes the effort, you know, to get what we want, even if we didn't realize we had set a goal. Case in point, You ever gone on a vacation with somebody and you ended up getting into a fight with them over the schedule? Sometimes men don't want to adhere to a schedule, so we get into fights with our partners. And then, oh, the partner storms off and, oh, mission accomplished, because now we get our alone time, right? It's ridiculous. I'm looking at the faces of the men in the room. They're very just no expression, but you know they've done it before. All right. So most people in good mental health, they take steps to kind of fashion their lives around the pursuit of their goals. Now, society does its part to reinforce this activity. So we're constantly bombarded by images of the good life, you know, whatever that is, to remind us, you know, stay on the path to accomplishing your life goals. So for example, you want that multi-story home in the suburbs? Well, you better make sure you get a job that you can keep, because an on again, off again kind of thing, that's not going to work if you want to hold down a mortgage, you know? Or maybe the busy city life in a loft and underground parking, you know, maybe that's what you're after. You better climb that corporate ladder, because those places are expensive. You got to make the right connections. You got to know the right people, study the right things. So we live life in service to our goals. You know, there is a problem with this though. And it is that our culture has failed to concurrently teach a very valuable lesson that it's okay to have goals and to work toward them, but are they the right goals? That's the part that we're missing, the right goals. Being successful at accomplishing our goals is all about setting priorities. But are we prioritizing the right things? I mean, if today's scripture has anything to say to us today, it's how steep a price that we can pay when we prioritize the wrong things. Prioritizing the wrong things, you know, it isn't a character flaw that people are born with. I'm going to make the case to you today that it takes a lot of practice, actually, and very little soul searching. If you're not the kind of person that likes to take stock now and again, yeah, you're going to be one of those people that's prioritizing the wrong things. Now, everyone takes, you know, time to take stock at some point in their lives. Sometimes they have to be forced to do it. You know, sometimes they're refreshing moments of introspection. Sometimes they're like a bolt from the blue. Our decisions in those moments, they change us. They change our trajectory. And we don't always realize it, but eventually everyone pauses and realizes, hey, you know, I'm not the same. I'm not the same person that I once was as time marches on. I mean, we can get so focused on achievement or pleasure or attending to our endless to-do lists. And then one day your focus, which has up to that point been so contracted, so utterly focused on your goal, it suddenly expands. You got to take in the landscape of your life. And often you find that you don't like what you see. You don't like how things ended up. You spent so much time focusing on what was ahead that you missed what was happening around you and to you. Now, based upon current health metrics, I am morbidly obese. I fall into that category. And in case you hadn't heard, obesity increases your risk of experiencing severe illness. I wasn't always like this. Thousands upon thousands of decisions and wrong priorities went into creating this health problem that I suffer from. In the moment, you know, they might have seemed right at the time. Oh, it's okay. I can have one more hot dog. One more piece of cake. Oh, I can sit at my desk for long hours and play video games. Yeah, felt good in that time. But maybe I chose to blind myself to the negative consequences. We do that all the time. But the thing is that I've had a great deal of practice getting into this condition, which is why I have been trying to get to a healthy weight for going on 20 years at this point. And the longer that I live like this, the harder it will be for me to reverse course, because I don't have any experience, or at least I should say I don't have much experience in the alternative. which is staying healthy, making the right decisions by my health, getting the exercise, doing the right things. I have way more experience doing the other things. Now, the process that led to my current condition is one that I see a lot as a pastor. You know, over the years, I've noticed a very curious phenomenon. And, you know, I've talked about it with other pastors. They have seen similar things. So when I'm asked to offer pastoral care or pay a visit to somebody, most of the folks before the pandemic that I saw, you know, they tended to be either around 80 years old or around 50 to 60 years old. The ones that were around 80, they're usually in good health. They're enjoying a quiet life in retirement. They have friends, social circles, activities, hobbies, healthy family dynamics, or at least most of them. The ones that are middle-aged, when I visit them, they're usually in a hospital bed. Sometimes they're surrounded by loved ones. And sometimes they're even about to die, painfully. Now, I don't know if it's a generational thing, but there is something about the way that most elderly folks have lived their lives that's different from the way that middle-aged folks are living their lives now. The middle-aged folks that I visit, they're almost never in good health. They're suffering from heart attacks or drug addiction, overdose, perhaps an accident at work, attempted suicide sometimes. So this next one goes out to the folks out there that have not yet reached 80 years old. I want to ask you, have you considered that the way that you're living life right now will determine whether or not you make it to 80? My mom always said that when you point the finger, there's three fingers pointing back at you. I'm taking that in too. I mean, maybe, frankly, there's some of you that don't want to reach 80. You know, that's true. I've had many a friend say that they don't want to live to be old. You know, they want to die and leave a beautiful corpse. What they don't realize is that people living in our country, they don't usually die like that. The age and condition in which people die is a direct consequence of genetics and how fortunate they've been allowed to live throughout their lives. If you treat yourself poorly, you're not going to die young and fabulous. You're going to die a slow, painful death. You're going to, and maybe assuming you had any friends or family left to love you, when you die, all they'll be able to say is, what a shame, you know, gone too soon. And then they'll have to move on with their lives. The way you choose to live your life doesn't just impact your life. You know, it impacts the lives of those around you. The decisions you take or you fail to take for yourself, they reveal a lot about the value that you place on other people. Though you will try to convince yourself that that is not true. When you treat yourself poorly, you treat your relationships poorly. Look, just think about what happens when you work extra hard to meet a deadline, let's say at work or school. Everyone around you suffers just a little bit more. You know, at best, you're unavailable emotionally, physically. At worst, you may even take your frustrations out on your loved ones. You snap at them. In the worst cases, trauma happens. Now, Jesus was sitting at a table in this parable that you heard him talk about. It's sometimes called the Great Banquet. Now, he was sitting at a table with some religious leaders, and these were people of high esteem. I should say men of high esteem. In the middle of the meal, a sick man is brought into the house. Now, you have to understand that Jesus was eating with a bunch of people that thought that they understood God. They understood how God worked. Some part of their understanding of God's law was violated by having this sick person brought in. But for the people that brought that sick person in, that was the right thing to do. They heard about Jesus. They heard about the way he heals people. And they brought him in. The sick man, you know, I don't think he really cared about all that stuff, you know, the law and all that. I think the sick man just wanted relief. Everybody in that scenario had their priorities. Now, Jesus, he heals the man on the spot. I mean, that's what Jesus does. He heals people. But not before asking the religious scholars, these folks that thought they had God figured out, if what he was doing was right, if he'd made the right choice, if he was stressing the right priorities. And these folks, they kept their silence, rightfully so. See, Jesus reminded them that if someone they cared about fell on hard times and needed help, but doing so would violate their understanding of God's law, in other words, their priority, top priority, they'd still provide help, especially if that person was, I don't know, their child or a valued companion. Yeah, some things are deeper than our religion, fair to say. Now, the parable of the banquet was part of a long lesson that Jesus taught about how important it is to have the right priorities and the deadly consequences for having the wrong ones, even if they seem so important in the moment. The guests that rejected the master's table in that parable, they did not arrive at the boldness they needed to decline the master's invitation overnight. These were people who had been practiced at turning this man down. Each lived their lives in such a way so as to make their present concerns, oh, I just got married, oh, I have an ox or a field to look after, to make their present concerns far more important than their friend's invitation. So when the master gets angry, I don't think that's hard to understand. I mean, this parable serves as a sort of allusion to the frustration that God may feel when we fail to prioritize the kingdom of God. I don't think it's tough to understand God's anger here. The master accomplishes two things in this story. So one, the master gave his cherished friends places away to complete strangers to bless them instead of his friends, who I guess didn't want to be blessed. And number two, the master provided a banquet to those who would most appreciate it. It was like a surprise for them, a very pleasant one, to be invited into this wealthy person's home to partake of a wonderful, wonderful banquet. And so this story serves as a warning as much as a lesson. So God's blessings are rich, they're always available. That's what grace tells us. But we might be so preoccupied with our goals that we might not even recognize the blessings. We're so busy trying to bless ourselves. And the word goal, you know, honestly, I think the word goal is really a small word for describing what it is that we truly value, what we think is a blessing, what we think will bless us. The most appropriate place for our concern and our focus. God, you know, yeah, the master was angry and said, you know, I tell you, not one of those who are invited will get a taste of my banquet. I don't think God removes blessings out of anger. The parable might make it seem that way. Honestly, I think we do that perfectly fine on our own. We rob ourselves of the potential blessings that God can bestow upon us. And because our priorities affect more people than just ourselves, we also rob other people of potential blessings. Let me tell you, I do truly believe that God blesses us so that we can be a blessing to others. God wants us and calls upon us to share out of our abundance, even though we might not realize we have abundance, to share out of our abundance and bless the world. You may not have realized this, but you truly do have a blessing that only you can provide to someone else or some group of people waiting in the wings. You might be aware of it. It might continue to improve throughout the course of your life, and it should. As we grow and as we mature, our faith deepens, our understanding of God deepens, and our ability to bless others deepens. So, what I would ask you to do today then, or maybe just throughout the week, take some time to really take stock and ask yourself, Are my priorities, my current priorities, are they truly blessing me? Is God speaking them into me? And how are my priorities blessing others? If you find that your priorities are not blessing others, especially those closest around you, you might want to rethink things a little bit so that you can get yourself back on track, so that you can be that blessing to others. And let me tell you, God smiles when you do. Let God's people say, amen. All right. So let me go ahead and perform another screen share. I'll bring up our prayer of confession. All right. Here is our order of worship, and there's our prayer of confession. Let us pray together. Loving God, we admit to attitudes that often exclude more than embrace. We would prefer the world to work as we see fit. We turn away from our responsibility to be a foretaste of your rule, and so neglect the poor, the immigrant, the orphan, and the widow. Save us from our sinful nature and make us worthy of your kingdom. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Let the scales fall from your eyes to take hold of the salvation that awaits your repentant spirit. God has made all things new. In the name of Christ, you are forgiven. Glory be to God, and amen. So instead of our traditional going to the Lord in prayer, that sounds weird, traditional. It's not really traditional, but we've been doing it. I heard that many of you had been offering testimonies. I'm not going to put anyone on the spot right now. However, instead of just typing your prayers into the chat function of the Zoom client or dialing in, or I should say texting in, or whatever your prayer requests, I'm just going to go ahead and open the floor to anyone that would like to lift up prayer requests. And then when folks are done, if somebody would be willing to pray over them, you don't need to have a lot of experience in prayer to be able to do a successful communal prayer. That's not what this is. This is us sitting and talking to God, bearing one another's griefs and joys, and offering them up to God. So the floor is open.
I request that the church family gives prayer and keeps Robin and Scott Trainer in prayer. They both have tested positive for COVID. Scott is asymptomatic. Miss Robin has mild symptoms. I have spoken with her yesterday and today. So just keep them in prayer.
For that update, Tasha. Anyone else? Just go ahead and unmute yourself. You should be able to do that. You may not realize you've remained muted if you're still trying to unmute yourself. So just if you're calling from a phone, you can either look on that home screen of your phone if you've got a smartphone, or you can type *6 and that should unmute you. Everyone else, sometimes it helps to ask for like a thumbs up, you know, if you're trying to say something and, you know, no one can hear you, so. I believe somebody hit their *6. Did somebody want to say something?
No, I pressed *6. I just want to say good morning, and I hope everyone is having a good day today.
Miss Gloria?
Yes.
Well, good morning to you, too. All right. If there's no others, let me go ahead and close this screen share. I'll mute all again. All right. Let's go to the Lord in prayer then. Gracious and holy God, we come before you with those concerns that have been lifted up, as well as those present in our hearts and in our minds, Lord. Especially we lift up the Trenner family. for what they are preparing to go through, Lord. We ask you to watch over that house, to let no evil come upon it, that your Holy Spirit might manifest within their bodies, anyone that is affected from the crown of their heads to the soles of their feet, that they might feel your Spirit abiding with them tangibly, reminding them that they need not be afraid and that you are indeed a healing God. Lord, for anyone else that is suffering the ravages of this terrible illness, gird us up, gird up our friends and family. Remind us we're not alone. Remind us that you are but a breath away, ever present, loving us all the time. Lord, for those suffering financial distress or loneliness in the midst of all this isolation, we ask you, Lord, make our burdens lighter. Help us to make each other's burdens lighter. Help us to bear with one another in spite of our own pain. For your love is made perfect in our weakness, Lord. And for any other concerns that have not been addressed, be present, Lord, because you know all things and you know the best possible outcome for those concerns. Lord, for the joy of each day, for the sun in our faces, warm temperatures and cold alike, for the gifts of food and family, for the nourishment we will partake, Lord, in just a little bit. We thank you. We thank you for simple pleasures. We thank you for every good and perfect gift that comes to us. Help us to notice the blessings, Lord. Help us to remember your abundant love. And we give up our cares to you, knowing that you will be present within them. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's join together in the prayer he taught us when he said, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. All right. Our closing hymn is Trust and Obey. The lyrics are included in your bulletin because they don't show up on the video here. Let me bring that up.
Oh,
I love the videos from that church. That pianist is something, isn't she? All right. Go ahead and, I see. There we go. Let's go ahead and go to our benediction. Go forth then from this place, knowing that God will accompany you to help you spread the blessings that God has put on your heart and within you to give to others. You are of incomparable worth to the Master. Don't sacrifice your place at the table. There is space for everyone at God's table. Go forth then to serve God and neighbor in everything that you do in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. All right. I don't have the ability to unmute all of you, so feel free to just unmute yourselves, okay? And have a blessed day.
Do you unmute services? Lem, this is Jethro. A couple of weeks ago, maybe 3 weeks ago, there was a video, and it was a group singing outdoors with the ocean. It appeared to be the ocean in the background, and an orchestra in front of them, and it was really spectacular. And if you ever have the opportunity to let us hear from them, I'd love that.
Yes, it's an academy. It's a Canadian academy. I'll look them up, but I know exactly which one. I'll look it up for you, and I can send you the information. No problem.
This is Anne Marie. I'm just really glad to see both of our hip patients here this morning and doing well, hopefully.
Yes.
Praise God.
Praise God.
Thank you all.
We're going to dance when we get together again.
Good morning, Dawn. Good morning, Dawn.
Hey, Al.
George.
Great. How you doing?
I'm doing pretty good. How you doing?
Fine, thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Nice service.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Have a great week, everyone.
Have a great week, everyone.
Where are Susan and Jennifer this morning?
Right there.
You're there?
Okay. In the corner.
Nothing special.
Okay.
Baby's doing fine.
The baby.
Baby is doing really, really well. Much better sleeper than Abe, so praise God. However, I personally am not getting as much sleep, but Bonnie is getting more sleep than me, and that's a good thing. So.
Good morning, everyone. This is Sandra Tucker. Good to see you back, Pastor. And I was wondering if anyone has heard from Jeff. I sent him a text message, but I didn't get any response.
Last week, Robin said that he was doing long shift hours and he wasn't getting much rest. You know, like his days were like 17 or more hours of work. So that's probably why. But I know he appreciates whatever you sent him.
Right. Thank you. I've been praying for him, and we should all just continue to pray for him that God gives him strength to hang in there.
That's right.
Absolutely. I did send out a group text that he was on, and he just replied that he missed us.
Okay.
But he didn't say any details about what was going on, which was fine.
Right. That's fine. I just hadn't heard anything, so it's good to hear
from you.
Good.
Everybody have a good week.
All right.
You too.
See you, everybody.
Great to see all your faces. It is. Mm-hmm. Well, see you all.
Good morning. This is Lawson Cooper sending out good wishes to all of our lovely church members. Have a good week. I'm looking forward to seeing you next week. Love you.
Same here.
Thank you, Lawson.
Thank you.
Take care, everyone. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
See you next
week.
Have
a good week.
Next week. Laura, hug the baby for me.
Every time I possibly can.
There you go. I told Nicole she'll probably be able to walk up to me and shake my hand by the time I get to see her.
She's this close. This close.
Wow.
Yeah.
All right.
See all you have to look forward to, Pastor? Two times over.
Right. Take care, guys. Have a good week.
Take care.
You too.
Take care. Love you all. Bye.
Bye. Love you too.
Good to see you all. Take care. Bye bye.
Hi, Linda. Okay. Have a good week, everybody. Take care.
Bye, everybody. Okay. Stay dry.
I have no idea.
All right, folks, not hearing anybody in the channel, although I do see at least six participants in the channel. I'm going to go ahead and close the session for everyone. Have a blessed week.
Have a good week.
Thank you as well. Got your message, Linda. I'll get with you in just a second, okay?
Okay, thank you.
Yep. All right. Take care, everyone. God bless.
Bye.